It's been an Augusta tradition for over 60 years. The Parade of Quartets, a powerful hour of praise with the best of gospel music, inspirational messages, and community awareness. All because... Good gospel's on the
Parade of Quartets. Listen, I'm blessed today to be able to present to you a first for the Parade of Quartet, and that is the seven last sayings of Jesus while on the cross. Can you imagine how, in fact, impactful the words of our Christ, the words of our Lord, have been throughout time? Because words matter, and we have seven preachers that are coming to share with us these seven last sayings. Make no mistake about it, words do matter. Patrick Henry will forever be remembered for saying, "Give me liberty or give me death." John F. Kennedy will forever be remembered for saying, "Ask not what your country can do for you, but ask what you can do for your country." During the trial of OJ, we'll never forget, "If it doesn't fit, you must acquit." And here recently, Michelle Obama will never forget those words, "When they go low, we go high." The seven last sayings of Christ mark for us a transition of Christianity and life as it is for the entire world. Jesus speaks three words, three sayings, between 9 a.m. and noon. While the sun is up, he speaks to others. And then those last four sayings of the Master are spoken during the midnight hour, yet at during the day. He speaks them from noon unto 3 p.m. I tell you what, I'm excited to hear what these preachers are going to give to us when it comes in terms to the seven last sayings of Jesus Christ. You're going to be blessed by what you hear today.
Pastor Mac, I'm just about as excited as you are with your introduction about these seven last sayings. So why don't we just jump right into it with our very first saying from Pastor B. Otis Clark from the Jerusalem Baptist Church right here in Augusta, Georgia.
Here Jesus is on the cross and realizing the pain and agony of the cross. He utters these dynamic words, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Oftentimes when we read that and study that, we think it's relative to the situation that he is in right now, that he's asking for forgiveness for those who put him on the cross at that period in time. But I like to believe that when Jesus said these words, he was going back in the past, not only that, but in the present and in the future. He was thinking about it in the past when he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." He was thinking about Judas, how Judas sold him out for 30 pieces of silver. Not only that, but Pontius Pilate, who condemned him to the cross. Not only that, but he asked for forgiveness for the people of Israel, the Jews, who congratulated him when he came to town. And then 1 week later, they said, "Condemn him, put him on the cross." I love this awesome word, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Not only was Jesus asking for forgiveness for those that were standing before him, but also I love it because I think he was saying, "Father, forgive them for those that are in the future, like myself and you who are listening to this program on this morning." Those awesome words, we have the confidence of saying and singing "Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see." Those words he uttered, we went from the dispensation of the law to the dispensation of grace. Thank God for grace. "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do."
Would one die for the righteous? Oh, Lord, and for a good man, you would defend. But God proved his love when I was yet in my sin. He was bruised for my iniquity. Thank you, Lord. Not because I've been so good or righteous.
Yeah, Pastor Mike, when we start talking about that Good Friday and the Calvary story.
Yes.
Listen, it was something real interesting that happened on the cross, and there were two thieves.
Yes.
And one of them we know by name, the other one we're not sure about. What really happened?
Wow. Interesting enough, both of them saw Jesus, heard Jesus, but didn't go where Jesus was going. Only one of them.
Only one made it.
Yes.
They heard the same thing.
Yes. Saw the same thing. Yes.
But only one received.
Yes.
Well, how interesting.
You can see Christ.
Yeah.
You can hear from Christ.
But will you accept it? Will you accept it? Listen, we got Pastor Tanita Cody.
Oh.
She's going to go ahead and break it down for us a little better than we can.
Bless us.
While we're here.
I'm here to share with you the second sayings of Jesus on the cross. It comes from the Gospel of Luke, the 23rd chapter and the 43rd verse. And Jesus said unto him, Verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. These are the words of our Savior Jesus Christ to one of the criminals. This criminal was being crucified beside him. He was in a desperate situation, knowing probably by sundown he would be dead. While on the cross, he came into the knowledge of who Jesus is. Jesus hanging on the cross next to him, body bruised, body bloody, his feet and arms nailed to the cross. Jesus was at his weakest moment, yet there on the cross, this criminal came to understand the heart of the gospel. He saw a king. He saw a savior. Because he recognized who Jesus was, he made appeal to him. He said, Lord, remember me when thou come into thy kingdom. At that moment, Jesus experienced the very purpose of his death. He answered and said, Verily I say unto thee, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. The moment the thief asked Jesus to remember him in his kingdom, Jesus gave him an immediate salvation. He said, today, meaning this very day, the day you will die, meaning he made it personal. He was letting the thief know, you shall be with me in paradise. Paradise is up for discussion. People discuss where it is or when it's going to be or where it will be. But to me, all I know is wherever Jesus is, that's where paradise is, because he told this thief, today you will be with me in paradise. And I don't know about you, wherever Jesus is, that's where I want to be. And one thing we can take from this is salvation can be immediate. Salvation is personal, and it's never too late to come to Christ. It's nothing you can do that's too terrible for him to save you. The moment you believe, he is willing to save you. Romans 10:9 says, if thou shalt confess the Lord Jesus with thy mouth, believe on him with thy heart, thou shalt be saved. Will you confess him today? Will you give him your life today? He's standing willing to save you so you can be like that thief and be with him in paradise.
Wonderful change. Y'all remember this? Has come over me.
What a powerful song.
that gives to us the event that happened on that third saying where Jesus is looking down at his mother and the mother, Mary, is looking at her son. What powerful attribute there is in mother's love. And yet the son, knowing he could not just leave his mother into anybody's hands. The Bible says that Jesus then looked at his mother and said, "Woman, behold thy son," as he looked at his disciple John and said, "Behold thy mother." Reverend Tossa Ramsey from the New Hope Baptist Church of Harlem, Georgia, is going to tell us all about this third statement.
This is the third saying of Jesus from the cross. In John's gospel, he gives an account of Jesus and his crucifixion and reminds us that human needs are both seen and met at the cross. In John chapter 19, verses 26 through 27, Jesus sees his mother and says, "Woman, behold your son." He also sees the disciple that he loves and he says to him, "Behold your mother." The Bible says from that hour, that disciple took Jesus' mother to his own home. The curtain of the cross opens to two scenes in John's account, the scene on the cross and the scene at the cross. Through Jesus, a new reality is initiated on the cross. As Jesus dies, the old covenant is passing away and the new covenant to redeem man and reconnect him to God is unfolding. This scene teaches us that the one initiating the new reality genuinely extends his saving power to all who are willing to meet him at the cross. It is here that we find John, the beloved disciple, and Mary, the mother of Jesus. They are both at the cross. While a new reality is being initiated through Jesus, a new relationship is also being integrated because of Jesus. Because of Jesus' divine love and human connection, the emotional, social, religious, and political needs of Mary are being provided for. The hymn writer reminds us that in the same way Jesus met the needs of his mother, he compassionately extends his loving arms to us. But we must be willing to meet him at the cross. Why? Because at the cross, where I first saw the light and the burdens of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Amen.
Good Gospels on the Parade of Waters.
Our fourth saying is found, of course, in the New Testament, but you wouldn't believe 1,000 years earlier, this saying was quoted by the psalmist David in Psalm 22. It says, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Interesting quote, interesting saying from the cross. Jesus is crying out to God, wanting to know, why have you abandoned me? But I think we're misquoted it. Sometimes we misunderstand, because if he was talking to the Father, how could he say that he had been abandoned?
Matthew 27:46 says, "And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, as to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" This fourth statement from the cross. This fourth statement is pivotal to Calvary. For if you examine the first previous statements, they were made between 9 a.m. and noon while the sun was out. And Christ spoke those statements to other folk. To others, he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." To others, he said, "Today you will be with me in paradise." To others, he said, "Woman, behold thy son. Son, behold thy mother." But now Jesus is transitioning from talking to other folk to now talking to his Father. But it's interesting because here it is, he does not use the term Father, but rather for the first time, Jesus invokes the term, my God, while he's on the cross. He opened up the dialogue on the cross with, Father, forgive them. He closed the dialogue on the cross with, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. But now he's saying, my God. And when he cries out at this time, it's interesting because it's noon, but yet it's midnight. Somebody's been there at the noon of your life, but yet it's midnight in your spirit. Jesus cries out and he says, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? It's interesting, and what a blessing it is, because scholars and theologians have debated this particular phrase from the cross, suggesting some have said that God turned his back on his son. Others have suggested that there's no way God could turn his back on himself. For in fact, when you look at John's gospel, John says that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then later on in John's gospel, he invokes the idea and the perception that the Word became flesh, that is Emmanuel, and dwelled among us. So in fact, when we look at what Jesus is saying, he's not necessarily saying that God has turned his back on himself, because God cannot turn away from himself. But Jesus is saying, God, I need your help. As he cries to his Father in the midnight hour of his life, yet being noon, he gives us the idea of how to handle our midnight situations. He simply says, I've got to give this to God. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Jesus feels in his humanity all of the pain and all of the sorrow and all of the scourging that he's experienced. And now he's at a place and point where he's taken upon himself the sins of the world. But here it is that in the writer, it's simply suggestive in the next verse that others was yet there. He could hear those that were in the crowd, but he's looking for God. He could hear those that have scourged him, but he's looking for God. It is for you and I to understand today that as we deal with the midnights of our lives, although it might be noon in our lives, you're 30 years old, that's a noonday, but yet you could be going through a midnight. You're 50, that's noon, but you could be going through a midnight. That in fact, we ought to go to God and give it to God and be persistent in our prayer to God, knowing that God is a very present help in our times of trouble. This word will let you draw closer to God while you're facing your midnight, while it's noonday.
I've had many tears and sorrow. I've had questions for tomorrow. There have been times when I didn't know right from wrong. But in every situation, God gave me blessed consolation. And all my trials come to only make me strong. You see, I've been a lot of places, and I've seen millions of faces. Sometimes I felt so all alone, but in my lonely hour, it became a precious lonely hour. Jesus reminded me I was his own. Let me tell you that thing with me.
Through it all,
through it all,
through it all.
Oh, through it all.
I've learned
to trust in Jesus.
I've learned
to trust in God.
Through it all,
God never failed me.
Through it all,
he never let me down.
I've learned
to depend upon him. Lord, I like this last verse. So now I thank God for the mountains, and I thank him for those valleys, And I thank him for the storms he's brought me through. For if I never had a problem, I would not know that God could solve them. I never know what faith in his word could do. Sing with me. Oh,
through it all.
Sometimes through the fire.
Through it all.
Sometimes through the rain.
I've learned to trust in Jesus.
Trust in Jesus.
I've learned to trust in God.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Through it all.
God never failed me.
Through it all.
Never let me down.
I've learned to depend upon His
depend
word.
Upon His word. Through sickness and pain.
I've learned. Depend on His word.
The 19th anniversary celebration of Blessed, and we want you and your family and all your friends to help us celebrate, featuring the Canton Spirituals.
You should have seen me bringing my cans.
The Swanee Quintet.
Jesus gave me a brand new walking out.
The Anointed Brown Sisters.
You
Gospel Originals, Roosevelt and Determined, and the Anointed Ones. Join in on the celebration on Sunday, May 19, 2019, at Transforming Live Bible Church, 2439 Peach Orchard Road, Augusta, Georgia. The doors open at 4 p.m. The concert starts at 5 p.m. sharp. Advance tickets $20, $25 at the door. Children 10 to 15, only $5. For ticket information, call 803-508-2992 or 803-634-8318 or 706-495-9957. Or at www.blesss-ed.com.
Good Gospels on the Parade of Waters.
Pastor Mike, I don't think our minds can even fathom what Christ was going through on the cross, even to the point he's 100% human, 100% God. He's God, died on the cross.
Yeah.
But the human flesh is weak.
Yes.
And he cries out, I thirst.
Yes. Yes.
What could it be?
Wow. I think we better let the preacher tell us.
And we have a good preacher to tell us.
Yes.
Reverend Coy Henderson from the Poplar Spring Baptist Church, he's going to just let us know what was that all about. Why did they give him vinegar when he was thirsty?
Yes.
I thirst. John chapter 19, verse 28. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scriptures might be fulfilled, cried out, I thirst. Beloved, when Jesus uttered these words, he had been on the cross for 6 hours. By now, all the suffering he had endured had taken its toll. Bleeding now from the 39 stripes applied to his back, the nails the soldiers had driven in his wrist, and a crown of thorns placed on his brow, he was sweating now profusely. Dehydration had set in. In his agony, perhaps with a fever, perhaps with a throbbing headache, perhaps with cramps or nausea, he groans out, I thirst. The only words he says that expresses his unbelievable suffering while he is yet on the cross. I thirst, first of all, substantiates his humanity. It proves that though Jesus was 100% God, he was 100% man. In his miracles, we see his divinity, but in his suffering, we see his humanity. Second of all, it satisfies the scriptures. The psalmist wrote in Psalms 69 and 3, I am weary of my crying, my throat is dry. Psalm 69, 21, they gave me gall for my food, they gave me vinegar to drink. Third, it certifies our salvation. Jesus, the water of life, became thirsty, that mankind's thirst for the water of life could be quenched by faith in the Savior. Beloved, I thirst not for tea, not for coffee. I thirst not for lemonade, not for a pop, but I thirst for what Christ alone can give. I thirst for his joy. I thirst for his peace. I thirst for his hope. Are you thirsty for Jesus? Are you thirsty for him? Are you thirsty for Jesus?
Jesus paid all.
Pastor Rodney Lockett from the Mount Pleasant Baptist Church over in Thompson, Georgia, is going to help us out with one of my favorite sayings from the cross, where it says, "It is finished."
John 19:30 says, "So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, 'It is finished.' In the Garden of Eden there, sin had entered the world because of the sin of Adam and Eve. Sin has now separated mankind, God's loving community, from him. And God is a holy God, and sin cannot be in the presence of God. And so now we find in Romans 3:23 says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Then we find in Romans 6:23, it says that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. And so Jesus had to come pay a price that we couldn't pay on our own. Jesus came down through 42 generations to be here crucified upon a cross. Jesus says that he has come that we may be saved. On the cross, Jesus was doing the work that we could not do. Now he proclaims, "It is finished. I have done all the things that my Father has called me to do. It is finished. It is over. It is complete. Now the way has been made for mankind to be reunited with God, our Father in heaven." When we hear "it is finished," it's not just the end of a race or the accomplishment of a feat, but it also means that it is paid in full. Sin has left a price that we could not pay. The price for sin is death, eternal separation from God. But here Jesus declares, "It is finished. I have paid the price, a price that we could not pay for ourselves." And so, my brothers and sisters, on this Good Friday, it's good to know that the debt has been paid. We don't have to pay the price, but all we have to do is know that Jesus paid it all. And where Jesus says it is finished, that's where our faith begins. When Jesus says it is finished, that's where our new life begins. And I don't know about you, but I'm so glad that Jesus came to pay a price that I could not pay. It is finished.
I tell you what, this is the final word that Christ gives from the cross, and what a blessing it has been to share these words and to hear the power of preaching, and we're going to hear just that. As Jesus gives this final word, Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit. He really teaches us how, in fact, we ought to die. Bishop Isaias Merritt, Macedonia Church in Grovetown, is getting ready to tell us how, in fact, we ought to handle this last word of Christ.
Today I'm talking about the last word that Jesus, the last phrase he gave in Luke 23:46. It reads, and when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And having said thus, he gave up the ghost. As I accepted the task of speaking on this final word, I picked up these words thinking that this has to be an issue, because it looks as if Jesus is plagiarizing, because I've seen these words before. As I studied the text, I looked back and found that in Psalms 31, the same words were said. And I was wondering, why would he say a word like this when it was said a long time before? Why would he use these words uttered by other folk in a time when he's transitioning from life to death? And it dawned on me as I thought about where I've seen other expressions of Christ, and I was reminded about John 1:1, where it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. And later on, we see that that same Word became flesh. So I was able to conclude that Jesus was not plagiarizing, but rather he was being what he was. The Word is Jesus, and Jesus is the living Word. Therefore, anything that is in the Word, Jesus is now fulfilling as the Word. With this new way of thinking, I took a second to look at the text a second time, and after the darkness had been on the earth for 3 hours, after the sun had been dark, after the veil of the temple had been torn down the center, he then speaks these words. He says, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. It's really Jesus being himself, a rhema word, activating a word that had been given centuries before. How is he the living Word in this particular setting? Because of who the Word was going to. He was the Word, because Isaiah said that the Word never goes out and come back void. Jesus had accomplished something here. He already said it is finished. Therefore, the Word was returning back to God in a sense of completion. So Jesus was the finished Word on the cross, returning back to the Father, the originator of the Word in the beginning. He also was a Word because of what and where he placed himself. He placed his spirit back in the hands of the very one who sent him in the first place. And I was wondering, well, why not go back to his face? Well, because if you go back to his face, that's worship. When Jesus went back to his hand, it was more about a work. That means that although the work was finished, the act of his work was not completely done. He had to still go into a borrowed tomb. He had to still get up early on Sunday morning. He had to still proclaim that all power was in his hand. And he had to still release the fact that the Holy Spirit would come into the church, to birth the church into the world. There's another element here that I want to highlight as I get ready to close. And that element is the word commend. And that word commend in the Greek, it actually means to entrust. Jesus entrusted himself into the only hand that would take him back to the place that he needed to be. I remember him proclaiming to Herod, he said, "No man can take my life, I lay it down." Therefore, he had to put what was important to him in a place where he could pick it back up again. And I believe that we all should take a lesson here, that we should trust in the Lord with all of our heart, leaning not to our own understanding, but in everything we do, acknowledge him, trust him, and let him handle your business. May God be a blessing to all of you. Shut up.